गुड आफ्टरनून।
हेलो,
इट इज माय ग्रेट प्लेजर एंड ऑनर टू इनवाइट डॉक्टर प्रोफेसर कपिल प्रोफेसर पब्लिक हेल्थ न्यूट्रिशन ऑल इंडिया इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ मेडिकल साइंसेज न्यू दिल्ली। हैविंग ट्रेन्ड इन पब्लिक हेल्थ न्यूट्रिशन एंड एपिडेमियोलॉजी, he is presently regarded as a national and international leader in the field of public health and nutrition. Professor Kapil has been involved in several major national research studies. He has been a researcher, teacher, policy enabler, advocate and activist who has worked to promote public health nutrition, especially in the field of prevention of micronutrient deficiencies across the lifespan. Professor Kapil has worked with in many countries as an advisory consultancy position and several national government and UN agencies, Indian Council of Medical Research, Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Ministry of Industries, UNICEF, WHO, USAID, and other countries. His contribution to public health nutrition has been recognized through several awards and honors, and these awards include B.C. Srivastava ICMR National Award for year 1992, received M.K. Seshadri ICMR National Award for year 1996, and Raju ICMR National Award for year 2002, and Har Gobind National Award of IAP for year 2009, and so many other awards from Nutrition Society of India, National Academy of Medical Sciences and Indian Public Health Association. And he is elected as a president of Indian Association of Prevention, Preventive and Social Medicine. I invite Professor Kapil Padi.
Quality of scientific evidence, we have
systematic review of randomized control trials, we have RCTs, systematic review of RCTs, and what we consider the gold standard now is meta-analysis of RCTs. So these are RCTs meta-analysis provide us the best quality of scientific evidence on which the decision scientific decisions should be undertaken. I'll touch upon this particular quality of evidence for the end of my presentation. If you look at in our country, the iron deficiency anemia is prevalent in all ages, male, female, young children, adolescents, pregnant mother, lactating mother. And even look at the iron deficiency, we have surveyed about 346 districts, and out of 286 are deficient to endemic to iron deficiency, that makes about 80% of total districts. And by and large, the food fortification is possibly the best strategy. Why I say so? Because the cost of the food fortification is borne by the beneficiary. If I want to get benefit of the or come out of a particular micronutrient deficiency, I take the fortified food and the cost is borne by the person. Take for example iodized salt. We all of us consume iodized salt and we are paying for the health benefits of the consumption of iodine. But what is important is that we should have adequate scientific evidence on a particular fortified product before we bring him as a public health intervention. Now, National Institute of Nutrition, ICMR, in the Institute of Medical Research, they developed a double fortified salt in 1986, and this was developed to combat iron and iodine deficiency simultaneously. So you consume double fortified salt, it will take care of your iodine deficiency as well as iron deficiency. Now what they did, they conducted the first field trial in 1989, and this was done in a community-based trial conducted in tribal population in East Godavari districts of Andhra Pradesh. And this was done, and what was found, they found that this is the East Godavari district, they did it in four blocks, and what they found was that results were inconclusive, they were contradicting to each other. Iodized salt group has a better iodine status, better iodine status, and so forth, and it was not taken into consideration. Then the second field trial was conducted by one double fortified salt, and they conducted a school-based study. It was residential schools, and this was done in 1986 to 1998. And the results of these studies and the earlier study was published by one of the authors in British Journal of Nutrition. In scientific groups, we take the quality of articles in the with vis-a-vis quality of journal which we have. Say Lancet has an impact factor of 40. So anything which gets published in Lancet is of high scientific quality. As compared to BGN, it has an impact factor of 5. Now what has happened that they talked about it and they said that overall these trials of trials BFS effectively controlled iodine deficiency, but a clear impact on reducing anemia was not demonstrated. So this was a study which was conducted on the results of the school-based study and the community-based study. Now, in this paper they have given that a randomized double-blind control study was undertaken in 1996-1998, and they followed the children at 6 months, 1 year, 2 year after the commencement of the study. The important issue which I would like to point out over here is that out of 500 children which were started at the baseline, at the end, there were only 107 were available for the end-line survey or the evaluation of the impact. Now, if you look at the 500 vis-a-vis 100, it's about 80% defaulter rate in the intervention study. Another important issue which was given in this particular paper was, if you look at the median urinary ID, this is very high levels. You know, now normally the population is consuming or excreting urinary ID levels more than 300, we call it that there is something problem with this auto-ionization. What we found that 5C5 was a median at the 1 year. Even in the girls, it was 615, means the iodized salt was super iodized. Okay, instead of 30 ppm, they might be adding 60 or 70 ppm of iodine, leading to such a high level of excretion of urinary iodine excretion level. So, and similarly, for the 2 years, 522 versus 414. Now, if you look at the VFS group or iodized salt group, they found that there was a high excretion of urinary iodine excretion level. But the most important thing which came out with the population in this particular paper was that when they conducted the iodine content of salt, what they found was that batch 1, the iodine ppm was 7 ppm, batch 2 15 ppm, batch 3 was 34 ppm. Now what is happening is that the iodine was not stable in the double fortified salt which was used in the in this particular trial. Now, when they collected, the range was, the iodine content was from 1 ppm to 48 ppm. Now, the existing scientific knowledge at that particular point of time say that iodine and iron both are like snake and nebula, mongoose. Both of them cannot stay together, because iodine has to stay, is stable in alkaline medium and iron is stable in the acidic medium. So both of them compete with each other, so they have become mutually exclusive as far as the micronutrient fortification in salt is concerned. Now what happens is, they concluded that by looking at all that data, there was a significant association between desirable shift of hemoglobin between right to left and so on and so forth. But the data which was interpreted was 500 baseline children were included and only 100 children were available at the end for the baseline evaluation. Well, they conducted this study and they came back to ICMR and they said that, well, our double fortified salt is very good. It should be included into the national program of ICTS and Mid-Day Meal. And we objected, some of the scientists objected, well, your data doesn't show that iodine is stable in the double fortified salt. Go back and look at the demonstrators, bring us the evidence whether the iodine is stable in double fortified salt or not. Well, they agreed to the ICMR expert group. And in 2000 to 2002, they conducted a 6-center study and double fortified salt was produced and they were sent to the different 6 regions of the country and stored as the normal iodized salt is being stored. And after 18 months, we tried to break open the codes and we found that iodine was not stable in double fortified salt. Well, they insisted, no, our salt is, our DFS is the best. So again, they conducted a study, or there were only 2 centers, and this was at Hyderabad and Delhi. And what they found was that after 3 months of the storage, they analyzed their data and presented it to a group, Scientific Advisory Council meeting of NIN. And they said that, but a new method was used. The old traditional method was not used. A new method was used. And then they said that, well, iodine is now stable. Now, the issue is, it comes to, this was the Scientific Advisory Council meeting which they had. Normally, these minutes are kept as a confidential document. Thanks to the RTI, you can get all this information. And what happened, that they say that first 3 months data on stability of IRD done at Hyderabad NIN and the ICCITT lab, and they found that IRD is stable. And they said that we have used not the sulfuric acid, but we have used the orthophosphoric acid for estimation of IRD. Now, they talked about it and they said that, well, 3 months, no losses. And then subsequently, it was detailed inspection was held and they said that, well, we can include this VFS in ICGS program and the midday meal program, but this was not published. There was no scientific publication on this particular study that the IRD is stable. Well, subsequently what happened that it was approved, but there were some doubts still went on. So what they did, the new method by which they conducted the study, the iodine content of salt was assessed in DFS in 2004. They published it in Indian Journal of Medical Research. By and large,
what happens? Not on. I have a single back benches are not able to listen. Okay. Now, so what happened that they tried to put down the results and they said that they published in IGMR. By and large, the IGMR policy is any publication that comes from the ICMR institutions using the utilization of ICMR funds, they get spread. It was published. Now, what happened that results, the conventional method of using sulfuric acid was not suitable for estimation of iodine in DFS, double fortified salt. We raised a query, some of the scientists raised a query, from 1986 to 2004, you have been using a conventional method and you have produced all the results with the conventional method. Now, for the stability of iodine in double fortified salt, you are using a new method. So what happens to the results which have been done between 1986 to 2004? Because all the results you have done with the using the sulfuric acid method. Now this was something which was slightly not palatable, not in consonance with the existing scientific literature. Well, the scientists have their own ways of doing it. In July 2005, Government of India made a committee to look into the whether the DFS can be used in double 40 for reduction of iodine deficiency disorders and improvement in hemoglobin. Now, these recommendations were submitted to the Government of India, and the minutes of the meeting said this was to examine whether DFS has any impact on reducing anemia and also examine whether the salt would require further fortification by other nutrients required for anemia like folic acid and B12. They very categorically mentioned the efficacy of the NIN DFS in controlling anemia can be inferred only from the study conducted in school children. A school children study where 500 was the baseline and end line you have only 100 children with 80% of dropouts, they had this particular minutes. And what they found was that yes, possibly there is an increase in hemoglobin, and so they also recommended yes, it can be used in the ICDS program and the midday meal program. What happened? NIN, they have been working on the salt for last 20 years. They immediately took up this opportunity and they started signing the memorandum of understanding with different salt manufacturers for production and distribution of double fortified salt. In fact, the most recent salt which has been produced in Tamil Nadu, known as Amma salt, is also double fortified salt and being fortified using the NIN formula. Well, immediately the Tata group was convinced And Tata also started producing double fortified salt, and it was a big launch which was made. And subsequently what happened, many more organizations started producing double fortified salt. This is some, I'll just come to the more detailed part of it. These are the companies which are producing double fortified salt in the country as of now. A very interesting situation arose in a Prime Minister Nutrition Council meeting. There were five scientists and all the ministers, secretaries and other people. And the Prime Minister was just about 6 months back, he made a statement that malnutrition is a shame for the country. And this was issue was discussed over there, so much of anemia, what we are doing, what we can do. We had a doctor who was being present in that particular meeting, and she said, sir, we have a double fortified salt, it can be used for prevention of anemia as well as iodine deficiency. Prime Minister immediately said, fine, if it is there, we take it. And immediately sometime in April, this was issued that for fortification of salt with iron and iodine should be included as a part of the national program. Once the Prime Minister issued in April, in June, the Minister of Women and Child Development started to all the secretaries that please use the double fortified salt in the different ICDS programs. Well, this thing happened. Some of us really felt bad about it. There's no evidence. And after all, you're taking entire population of this country for a ride. And so we met Dr. Katoch, a very eminent scientist, a very nationalistic person. And we had discussions with him. And we told him, sir, this is what is actually happening. He said that, well, I do not know. So again, he constituted an expert group. And this expert group had a meeting in November 2011 that, okay, let's look into the expert group, or what is the existing status of the double fortified salt. And we had a meeting in sometime in November 2011 after 6 months of giving a judgment by the PM that DFS should be used. And then we had some recommendations that data on and publication stability, shelf life, bioavailability of the DFS produced by NIN should be shared with the expert group members. And some of these expert group were there to look into the what is actually happening. Now, ICMR kept on sending letters to NIN. There was no response. Okay, no response. What can be done? No problem. This is a letter which was sent by the member secretary of this particular group that NIN, please send us the results or all the data about it. We could not get it. But what happened? In 2014, there was pressure groups which are being developed, and they told to the Ministry of Health, well, Ministry of Women and Child Development supports the DFS. Why don't you support the DFS? So under the pressure, the Government of India Ministry of Health and Family Welfare also issued notice to all the secretaries, all the commissioners that please start using the double fortified salt in your for the prevention of iodine deficiency and increase in hemoglobin. Well, I just tried to tell you the story. We do not have any data on efficacy of double fortified salt. We do not have any data on effectiveness of the double fortified salt. We do not have data on the stability of iodine in DFS. Okay, there's a scientific evidence is very weak, one of the lowest one, the expert's opinion. I say something that becomes an expert opinion without any scientific publication, without any peer review and so forth. But the production and distribution of double fortified salt is ongoing in the country. Well, this is the expert opinion is the lowest scientific evidence which has been used for distribution and production of double fortified salt. And millions of millions mothers and children, they have been consuming or they have been given by the government under the PDS system, under the ICDS system, thinking that it will help in improving their hemoglobin. Well, in 2015 also we didn't have any minutes for our responses from the NIN. Again, the entire plan, all the ministries are putting up in their plan budget for the inclusion of double fortified salt. And some of the, my colleagues asked me, Dr. Kapil, what's your problem? What's your problem? Why are you pursuing this issue? Why? What's your concern? My concern is very simple, straightforward. Cost of iodized salt is 6 to 8 rupees a kg. When you take up the cost of double fortified salt, it is 20 rupees a kg minimum. This why I am telling you a figure of 3 years back, it must have gone to 22 rupees now. There is a poor stability of iodine in double fortified salt. So wherever you are giving double fortified salt, you are replacing the iron fortified salt or iodized salt, which has a proven track record of prevention of iodine deficiency disorders. So what you are doing, you are destabilizing the IDD control program in the country. Now, this is the scenario. If you ask too many questions in a scientific meeting, which are uncomfortable to the organizers, so there are very high chances that you will not be invited next time. Okay, and I can vouch for that. Okay, now what happens that it's always difficult to swim against the tide. But it's going on, we keep on fighting the battle. Thank you very much. I stand by these slides. These slides are with the organizers. Anybody can use this. Anybody can pick up these questions, clues from here and put up to the whomsoever they want. And I stand by these slides. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Kapil, for reviewing the issues and evaluating the data on double fortification of the salt. Now the forum is open for the questions.
Good afternoon, sir. So I'm a 6th semester MBBS student. My question is, are there any other better food candidates for iron fortification other than salt?
Well, what is happening is that wheat flour has been fortified with iron. But normally the fursolate was being used. Then wheat flour has phytates, so the efficacy was poor. More recently, the sodium iron EDTA compound has come. It's costly by 6 to 8 times. But the impact studies have shown that yes, if you use the sodium iron EDTA, it's going to make the difference as far as the hemoglobin is concerned. So it's available.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, I would like to ask a question.
Yes, ma'am.
Whatever the salt we are taking from the market, that is the DFS?
No, ma'am. Actually, what is happening is the government is the biggest buyer of the any commodity, and when it's put down to the PDS system, they buy lakhs of what you call kg of salt. So right now, say in state of Chhattisgarh, they are providing 2 kg of salt by the health department, 1 kg by Ministry of Women and Child Development and the ICDS program. So everybody gets the DFS. Now, almost 16 states in the country, they have included DFS as a part of PDS system. So all the salt which is being, normally it is about 20-22 rupees a kg, but under PDS it is being sold at a 4 rupees a kg. So heavy subsidy is being given under the PDS for almost all the items, which includes the DFS also.
Thank you, sir, for explaining.